The resource person for the last technical session is Dr. Mamta Mokta, Professor, Department of Public Administration, Himachal Pradesh. Dr. Mokta is a brilliant scholar who has 28 years of teaching and research experience. She has written more than 74 research articles. She has completed 5 research projects. Dr. Mokta has produced 10 PhDs and presently is advisor of Himachal Consumer Protection Council. She is also associated with various NGOs and government organizations. She will be deliberating on professional codes of ethics in teaching and research. Welcome, ma'am, to the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you. First of all, good evening, everyone who have joined this virtual platform. First of all, I acknowledge and appreciate initiative taken by Government College Dhami, Government College Jammu, in collaboration with the Cape Comorian Trust India in organizing this international faculty development program on such a relevant theme. Yeah, theme is quite relevant, especially in the time of the pandemic, where the need of the deliberations, especially on the topic like ethics, they are very much required. I'm thankful to Dr. Anita for giving me the opportunity to interact with the nation builders this evening on this virtual platform. In this session, before me, Dr. Gul, she has talked about the dynamics of the tour. She was from Turkey, and then I have listened to Dr. Darshan from Sri Lanka. He has talked very, you know, minutely about the ethics in the research. And my topic, that is, I'm going to talk about the professional code of ethics in teaching as well as in the research. First of all, when we talk about something, deliberate about something, the first question that comes in our mind, why we are talking about this particular issue? I think that everyone knows that out of the 17 sustainable development goals that United Nations has given to all the countries, the fourth Sustainable Development Goals talks about quality education. And quality education means that education, on the one hand, in the quality education, we talk about the quality ethics in teaching. Another one is the ethics in research. They are very, very important because they are concerned with the quality teaching. And in this direction only, that our new education policy 2020 that was given last year, they also put a lot of emphasis on the creativity, upon the innovations, that we have to be, you know, we have to do the teaching in such a way and promote the research in such a way that innovation, creativity, it should be promoted. And National Research Foundation of 50,000 crore has also been, provision was made that it's going to be set up just to promote the research activities in our country. But we see that in 2020, the average age of Indian in our country was just 29. We had the demographic dividend with us. And this demographic dividend, we can mold this demographic dividend through our proper research and teaching in the direction of, you know, development process. We need development of the, you know, community, development of society, development of nation. All they are directly or indirectly related with the education and research. Especially when we talk about the research, on the one hand, ethical teaching leads to character building, and ethical research, it's very, very important. If the research is ethical, it is going to facilitate, you know, in the, you know, our country can lead ahead with in the, you know, in the field of the inventions, discoveries, and creativity, patent, copyright, intellectual properties. We can frame the good policies, we can take the feedback from the people, citizens, how they are feeling with the policies, and accordingly we can renovate and improve. So research is very, very important. Research is just like the manure of the soil of the country, you know, they give the feedback. So it's not that you know, education institutions, they are very, very important. They are directly or indirectly related with the growth of the country. And we can see that code of conduct. So when we want to improve this you know, education and research, what should be the mode? What we should do? Whether we should adopt the code of conduct? What is this code of conduct? First, let's understand this. Code of conduct. It's not just in the teaching and research we talk about the code of conduct. In various countries, especially for the parliament also, we talk about the, and especially when we talk in the India context, in the Lok Sabha, in the Rajya Sabha, there is also a code of conduct. We have the ethical committee in the Rajya Sabha that was set up in 1997. In the Lok Sabha, this ethical committee was set up in 2000. And then not only for that, of course, that's another thing, that to what extent our, you know, representatives, and what is the type, what type of behavior they display in the parliament, that's another issue. But this ethical committee, it is there, no? Or it's not only for the, you know, our representatives, this ethical committee gives the recommendations, but for our public servants, civil servants code of conduct, public servants code of conduct, and code of conduct for the government employees, it is also there. And not only in the government sector, but in the private sector also, in the companies also. Especially there was a Tradeway committee and commission that gave the recommendations, if you want to improve the working of the private companies, there should be code of conduct for all the companies. And it's not only that code of conduct should be orally, it should be in written form, so that every employee can understand what is this code of conduct. So we see that code of conduct, it is for everyone. So that's why the code of conduct in teaching and research, that is also very, very relevant. Why this code of conduct we talk about? Because this code of conduct, it makes the teacher responsible, accountable. And responsibility and accountability, they are the essence of the development, essence of the good governance. And it is rightly said, if you salute your duty, you don't need to salute anybody. And if you pollute your duty, you need to salute everybody. Yes, it's true with the teaching profession also. Before starting this topic, why this professional code of ethics we need in our country? Let's analyze. To what extent we are contributing? I just talk about that research, they form the basis of intellectual property. We understand in the intellectual property index that was just released in 2021, our country's stand was just 40 out of 153 countries. US, Japan, Europe, they were, first position was of US, second Japan, third Europe, and we were at 40th position. It means that intellectual property, demographic dividend is with us. We are the youngest population. But even then, intellectual property, not to that extent that we have. To what extent we are innovative? In 2021, again, the index that was given, it showed that our country position was 48 out of 131 countries. Innovation, it was also not there to that extent. And in the field of the innovation, the topmost country was the South Korea, second one was of Singapore, Switzerland, and Germany. They were quite ahead of us. So in field of innovation, intellectual property, there's a lot of distance that we need to cover. And on the other hand, we see that the recent release World University Index, what are the best universities all over the world? India's, you know, on the one, the Oxford position, Stanford, it was of second, and Harvard was at the third position. And regarding when we compared in context of our country, position. It means that ranking wise, of course, we are not at the first, second, third position in first 10, 20 position, but anyhow, somewhere, not a good position, but anyhow, somewhere we are standing. And previously, I was just listening to the resource person. He was talking about the Guru Shishya Parampara. Yeah. In our country, Guru Shishya Parampara, it was very auspicious. And let's say where we stand, what is the status of the teachers in our country? Again, when the status of the teachers in our country, it was analyzed, it was a nice feedback that was given regarding the teachers of our country, that our country stand at 6th position. And on the first position, it was of China, Malaysia, Taiwan, Russia. They were, ahead of us, but we were also not at the bad position. 6th, it means the respect, esteem that is given to the teacher. It was good in India. And it was the survey of the 35 countries, people, they were surveyed, and they just give the feedback that how the, people, the community, the nation feels about the teachers. In such scenario, the biggest challenge before us that if we want to improve in these areas, in these indexes, we need ethical teaching as well as ethical research. And I was, attending your this session yesterday also, and there was a lot of good discussions and presentation they were given regarding the, how we can improve the research work. And I'm also going to touch those topics, but I've just heard about their presentations, so I would like to skip those, issues. But I would like to add certain points here. I'm going to share my presentation now. Whether my presentation is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
You know that I've talked about the sustainable development goals is also giving us the hint that no, the time has come. We have to talk about the quality education, quality teaching, and for that we need ethics and ethical teaching as well as the ethical research. And education is by which the character is formed, strength of the mind is increased, the intellect is expanded, and by which one can stand on his own feet. And since the coronavirus pandemic first emerged, we have seen the 1.5 billion learners across the world, they're impacted by the school, college, and university closures. And in these unprecedented times, now more than ever, it is necessary to do all we can do to ensure young people throughout the world have access to a good teacher. And this is the time that this time we can utilize for the research also. And while, pursuing our research, the ethical research, how we can pursue the ethical research, it can be helpful. And the COVID-19 pandemic has also assured in new threats to the academic freedom. Most important thing, when you talk about the ethical teaching as well as the ethical research, one more question that comes in our mind, that to what extent the academic freedom, it is related to the, ethical teaching as well as the ethical research. Ethical academic freedom, to what extent a guided way to conduct the research, to what extent to choose the topic of his choice, and the students want to pursue the research, and what are the freedom, the facilities, the institutions, infrastructure that's being provided to the student in our country, to what extent the environment, whether it facilitates ethical teaching, whether it facilitates ethical research, that is also very important questions. And when we see the academic framework, we see that in the academic framework, again, the position of India, it was put at the question mark. The academic freedom to the extent that was required, it was not there in our country that we provided. So that's why to restore the this academic freedom, we need to put more emphasis upon the ethics, professional code of ethics that should be adopted. Ethics, they are the principles and guidelines that guide behavior. Teacher ethics are statements that describe or delineate what is acceptable conduct for the educators. What is wrong? What is right? What are the standards? What are the principles? What are the guidelines? And how we are going to move ahead with such torchlight that is very much required. A professional code of conduct, it outlines the teacher's primary responsibility to their students, and researchers and define their role in students' life. Educators must demonstrate the impartiality, integrity, and ethical behavior in the classrooms also, as well as while guiding the research also. These words, they look so simple, but they have the deep meaning, they have, you know, deep rooted in the psyche, in the behavior, and then they affect, you know, the teaching as well as the, you know, research. Ethics is a sort of commitment to the positive values, a communal activity applying, you know, rational principles and universal standards to social life, about real power relations and responsible power sharing. And it's a sort of, you know, moral, it enforces the morality, the moral character about active participation in a moral community. It's a problem-solving activity in educational process. So ethical is something that should be relating with the problem-solving activity. We are not pursuing research just for the degree. We are pursuing research to solve some problem. The problems in the society, there are so many varied problems in the society. If we are pursuing a research just for getting the degree, not doing, that's not contributing anything for the community or for the nation, that research is of no use. It's very, very important that research should be relating to what? To the reality, to the present time problem, so that we can contribute something for the, you know, society. And the biggest difficulty with the mankind today is that our knowledge has increased so much faster as compared to our wisdom. And how we can tackle this problem? Again, we can tackle this problem through what? Ethics. Why there is a need of professional code of ethics in teaching in the research? First of all, the written code of conduct. Code of conduct is required, but they should be in written form. Generally, who's going to enforce? Ethical committees in Lok Sabha also, Rajya Sabha also, code of conduct for the civil servants, public sector employees, private sector employees, but they themselves take that. You know, whenever the private sector employee joins the company, he has to sign the, at the time of the joining, he has given those code of conduct that, look, when you are performing your duties here in this company, you have to follow this code of conduct. Similarly, the written code of conduct for the teachers, they should be given at the time of their joining. How this concept of code of conduct, professional code of conduct for the teachers came into the practice? All of us know that we must be aware about the Anna Hazare, and hum sabhi jante hain. Anna Hazare crusade against corruption that was started in 2011. At that time, this concept of a professional code of conduct for the teachers, it was triggered. They said that because that moment it was on the corruption. They said, if you want to tackle the corruption, for that, it's very important. Our future generation, they must have ethical, you know, behavior. And how to inculcate ethical behavior? For that, we need, you know, code of conduct for the teachers, so that they can make the worthy citizens and they can contribute for the, you know, in the development of the country. And in the eradication of the corruption, and that point of time, it was a code of conduct, it was drafted, and it was, a committee was set up, workforce was set up, and that workforce prepared a code of conduct, and it said that, look, this code of conduct, it is in the written form, not every higher education institution should adopt this code of conduct. Of course, that code of conduct in some universities, in some colleges, that they had developed their own code of conduct, and they asked their, you know, teachers to follow this code of conduct so that, you know, quality teaching as well as the quality research, it is promoted. And the purpose of the code of conduct, it was to enable the teachers to deal consistently with all students and researchers, to ensure that teachers are interacting in a professional manner. It's very, very important. You know? This code of conduct that is required to uphold the dignity of the teacher. We are at the sixth position, but we have to uphold this dignity, and we have to put a check on the academic dishonesty. We have to mold the young minds, and that's a very sensitive, very important role that has been assigned to a teacher. And through this code of conduct, we can make disciplinary process easier. And we can check what is right, what is wrong, what is unethical behavior. It acts as an instrument of self-regulation. This is very, very important. The code of conduct, there's a very important word, self-regulation. It is a self-imposed. And it's a self-imposed that it's a torchlight that gives the direction that how we can move ahead in that particular direction. To represent a status symbol that protects the profession. If we have the ethical code of conduct, the status, the dignity that's attached with the teaching profession, it's going to be protected. And it's very, very important. And then to foster the culture of the high standards of the honesty, integrity, ethical and law-abiding behavior among the teachers. To encourage the observance of standards to protect and promote the interests of students and institutions. To set out the responsibility, these two words, responsibility and accountability. If that is fixed, naturally, through this accountability and responsibility, we can make a roadmap that can take the students, this community, this nations towards the leading height. And this code of conduct, it's very, very important because it develops the ethical foundation of the good teaching in his subject. How this ethical code of conduct, that's very, very important. In framing this ethical code of conduct, I already talked about this academic freedom index. To what extent academic freedom that's being given to the institutions and, you know, our universities, our colleges, autonomy, that's being given to the colleges, it's also very, very important. Because, you know, when we talk about the ethical teaching, ethical research, you know, we should also see that our ethics should not, you know, it should not be embedded down in just in the bureaucratization process. There should be autonomy also. So freedom of research and teach, freedom of academic exchange and dissemination, institutional autonomy in the campus, integrity, freedom of academic and cultural expression, constitutional protection of academic freedom, international legal commitment to academic freedom under the International Covenant of Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights and existence of the universities. These are the indicators. On these indicators, the academic freedom of a country that is assessed. It was very surprising that in this academic freedom index, Uruguay and Portugal, they top this academic freedom index, and our position of our country, it was not so good. And it was pointed out in this index that in India, just because of so many compulsions, the bureaucratization process, political interference, that the academic environment is not free, and to that extent, we can say that the academic environment is not giving the right feedback. So that was, these are the challenges, how we can, on the one hand, we have to maintain the academic freedom. On the another hand, we talk about the ethical research and teaching. So these topics, they all are intermingled and they affect. Regarding, we can say that code of ethics, this code of ethics, when we talk about this code of ethics, they governs the decision making and the code of conduct governs actions. Sometimes a comparison that is also made between code of ethics and code of action, code of conduct. Code of ethics, it's a consciousness, it's a moral force that tells us that, look, this is right and this is wrong behavior. And code of conduct, to what extent we follow the code of ethics, that is code of conduct. Both codes, they provide the direction to the teachers. Both codes regulate the teacher's behavior in the different ways. A code of conduct or ethics that governs how the person to whom it applies conduct herself in the ethical manner. So it's very, very important that code of conduct is essentially a set of professional ethical standards with which the teacher are required to comply. Code of ethics and code of conduct, both are very, very important in professional organizations if they want to achieve the new heights. This is a code of ethics. It is an aspirational document, general in nature, based for conduct, publicly available to everyone who is, teaching in that institutions, focus on values and principles. They regulate the judgment. probity, integrity, and compassion. It's a sort of the preamble of the code of conduct when we talk about teachers being an integral part of the social environment, share the needs and aspiration of the people. There's a need to enhance the self-esteem of the teachers, and that can be enhanced through this adopting this professional code of conduct. And these are the ethical principles. This code of conduct, they focus that, look, we should try to adopt these principles while we are pursuing our profession. These are the ethical principles. And now, these ethical principles, now I'll break up these ethical principles, you know, ethical conduct towards research. In this new education policy, the more emphasis is now put that met Dr. Anita, she was also, you know, talking about this, that in the new education policy, there's a provision that some universities and colleges, you know, they will be specifically marked for the research. One teacher, it's not essential a good teacher will be a good researcher also, or a good researcher will be a good teacher also. Yeah, it's very true. And that's why, you know, two types of, you know, universities. One is the research-oriented, and another one is the teaching and research. And in the new education policy, there's a provision also that it's the four-year, you know, that 4 years spent in the colleges, three for the, you know, degree, and those who want to opt 3 years, it's up to them. And those who want to opt for the 4 years, the fourth year it will be just for the research purpose. Now research will be there in the colleges also. So that will be part of colleges, universities, research. How this ethical conduct toward the research? Code of conduct covers ethical conduct towards research, towards students, towards profession, towards cliques, towards the parents of the students, towards the community. It's also very, very important. It's not just we are working in an institution, we are just concerned with the students. No, we are concerned with the community also. That's why, you know, we are nowadays talking about that universities and colleges, they are adopting a village, and they are, you know, students, they are going to the villages. They are involved in the social activities. Social responsibility that has also been given to the students. We are involving other stakeholders in the development of the society. Ethical community towards the society. It's very, very important that the conduct, it must include all these things. First, we cover the research integrity. How, when we talk about that professional code of conduct in the, virtually that in the research, the attitude and habit of the researcher to conduct research based on appropriate ethical, legal, and professional framework obligations and standards. We want that research integrity. It should be there. You know? And research ethics means application of ethical principles or values to the various issues and fields of the research. These ethical principles of the research, they are that previously I was just listening to the resource person. He was touching all these aspects. So I'm not going to detail into these ethical principles. Integrity, competence, no, he has talked to everything. I was just listening. So that I don't want repetition. That's why ethical principles that we should try to conduct the research within the ambience of these, you know, components. And principles of research ethics, that it's very, very important that discuss the intellectual property frankly. Now comes the role of the teacher first. Generally, what happens? The first thing that comes in our mind while conducting the research, what type of infrastructure or facility we are have in our country? I just want to share one example. One day I was in the department and I just got a, you know, call from a student from USA. She asked me, madam, I'm a researcher, I'm pursuing my MA, and I just want to, you know, come to university to talk about some, you know, issues not on a particular topic that on the research that I'm pursuing. I was a bit surprised that, you know, you are just a post-graduation student, you are in the, you know, just doing the post-graduation, not an MPhil degree, not a PhD degree, even then you want to come into our country. I said, okay, if you want to come, you can come. Okay, she asked me, madam, just give me the time. When I come and, you know, have deliberation with you, I just told that you can come in this particular date. And after, you know, 2-3 months with the date that I have given to her, she came to my department. And she told me that she is working on, you know, to what extent the development is being there in the developed and developing countries. And she's comparing the development in developing countries. In the developing countries, she has taken the example of the India. And in India, she said that in the governance index, because the Himachal is leading ahead, that's why I have taken out of India this state of Himachal Pradesh. And being you are in the Department of Public Administration, I want to come to you and discuss certain issues. I said, okay. But I was quite surprised. When she came to my office, she put a speaker on and she took my interview. And hardly, you know, 1.5 hour interview. She asked me so many questions, I was a bit surprised. Look, you know, she is not from Himachal. She's not even from our country. Even then, she knows so much about Himachal. Yes, she has that inquisitiveness. She wants to learn, know more and more. And that makes it something, you know, special about the research. And second example, I just want to share. It means that sort of, learn something, do something, something, know about the roots. That I feel that whether that inquisitiveness of mine, whether they are available in our students or not. Second thing I just want to share, one of my friend, he's just pursuing his, talking about that principles of the research ethics, I was just sharing, example that one of my friend, he was just sharing his experience that, you know, for the PhD, he was pursuing from the USA. He told that he just entered the library. And as he entered the library, you know, the people who were sitting on the front asked him that, look, you know, on what topic you are just working in our country? He just shared the idea when he entered the, you know, library. And after 1.5 hour, when he came back, you know, the library staff was ready with the, you know, photo state of the various, you know, research articles, books, and they just shared, sir, we have, you know, collected all this data, all this, you know, books, journals on the relevant topic. It's for your consultation. We are going to here to assist you. If that type of academic environment it is there in the university, of course, the type of research that they are going to produce, it will be definitely different. So the principle of research ethics that you talk about, it's very, very important that discuss the intellectual property frankly, be conscious of the multiple rules, follow the informed consent rules. And this, within such environment, that we can say that research that we conducted, it will be of different. When we say about the ethics in the research, at different levels, you know, ethics will be followed in the, first in the research problem, research questions. At every level of step of this research, the ethics in research is going to attain importance. First of all, research problem. Sometimes the selection of the problem is done in such a way, look, the research has already been done on this particular topic, it's going to assist me, that's why I'm going to choose this topic. No, the problem should be new one. Ethics says, the convenience says, the problem should be repeated. But ethics says, no, the problem should be a new one, you know, so that we can do something new. We can contribute something to the community, something to the society. It is a significant problem that will benefit others. So first thing, the ethics that come in the mind in the selection of the problem. You know? And have you done a thorough literature review to see if other studies exist? If it doesn't exist, then only we are going to choose. So ethics guide in the selection of the problem also. In research design also, is your choice of the study design an ethical choice? Is it methodologically sound? Do you have the expertise to do it or not? And then research questions. Does it expose the participants to unacceptable risk or invasion of the privacy? Clearly identify the purpose of the study of the participants. And the informed consent. It's also very, very important. Who are the researcher and their contact information? Who is sponsoring? What is the purpose of the research? Everyone must be clear. And then, you know, informed consent about the participants. How were they selected? And at every level, you know, the type of ethics that is required, it is very, very important. And that in the data collection also, ethics has played an important role. Respect the participant in research sites. respect privacy and the confidentiality. Monitor. Sometimes what happens, for the data collection researchers come to us and we say, okay, we don't have the time. And he's just a student. And then he comes for the next time. Again, we say, okay, I don't have the time. Just come some other time. And the day will come. The researcher will say, madam has no time. It's better that I'm going to fill this questionnaire myself. And that happens in reality. And again, you know, ethical standards deviate. So data collection, it is very, very important. Data, while collecting the data, we should respect the participants and research sites, how to collect the exact data without not only the collection of the data, the analysis of the data also. Again, the ethical standards, they affect our analysis also. How will you protect the anonymity of the participants? How will you analyze the data? Do you have the experience? How long will you keep the data once analyzed? Where and how will you keep it? At every step, the ethics has an important role. And then in the research disseminations, authorship, who will do what and when, authorship order, conflict of interest, it's very, very important. Sometimes, you know, we conduct the research and the two persons, they are sharing that research. And while we are publishing that article, publishing that research, then we are not giving that due credit to the another one. Again, the ethics come into practice. And then, you know, research dissemination, it is also very important. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we can hear you, ma'am.
Okay. Ma'am, kindly wind up within 5 minutes because it's still 8:30. We'll take up a few questions. Sorry.
Okay, no problem. Research dissemination, again, the question, it is there. I just want to, the main points that I just want to, you know, share here, that, you know, just to put that there should be ethical research. What the UGC has done? UGC has just brought out, you know, you have already talked about this. I'm not going to touch this. A new regulation that UGC has adopted, that new regulation, it is regarding the how to maintain the academic integrity and how to put a check on the plagiarism. That is a, you know, for that, this regulation, new UGC promotion of academic integrity and prevention of plagiarism in higher education institution regulation in 2018. Just to put a check on the plagiarism, it's very important that if we want to pursue the ethical research, there should be no plagiarism. And what plagiarism is, you are all listening to that plagiarism. I just want to add this, just this regulation. This regulation says, because one thing is plagiarism and one thing is the, you know, similarity. Similarity means that the same, sometimes what happens, that we copy and paste as such without changing the language. That is called similarity. And plagiarism is means that we quote a particular person, particular research without citation, without giving acknowledgement. So plagiarism and similarity, they are dealt properly in this regulations. And in this regulation talk about that there are going to be 4 level. One is the L0. When the similarity index, it is between 0 to 10%, then, you know, that will be acceptable. Second grade will be of L1. When similarity index, it will be between the range of 10% to 40%. Then, no, it will be sent back. And 6 months will be given to the researcher. You revise it and just reduce this similarity to 10, below 10%. And on the another hand, this 6 months time that is being given, and the teacher that's being asked that, look, you cannot supervise till 1 more year to any student. And third one level, it is called L2 level, 40 to 60% similarity index. Again, one, if that is found, the thesis is sent back and said that you revise it and submit after 1 year. And if the similarity index, it is above 60%, it is cancelled. And Ido, the supervisor said, you cannot now supervise for the 3 years. So some sort of preventive punitive measures have been adopted to just put a check on the plagiarism. So it's the duty of the teacher just to tell the researcher, the student, that what the plagiarism is and what the similarity is. And differentiate between them, make student aware, so that, you know, it's very, very important. Generally, what happens? One more thing I just want to point it out here. Generally, what happens? We put the plagiarism check. For the plagiarism check, checking the similarity index, we sometimes use the online softwares. And when we put our research work on the online software, it automatically goes in the repository. Suppose in the first time it says, okay, I have the 40% similarity index. It goes in the repository. And when again I'm going to check after doing the correction, it says, now you have 100% similarity. I was surprised how pehle to 30% tha, now it has been increased to 100%. Why? Because that is the problem. And we don't even, you know, sometimes we don't even tell our students and he faces the problem. It's very, very important that when we are using the software for checking the plagiarism, software, it should be an authentic software. Tintin and Urkun, the authentic software should be there. And most important thing is that while using that software, we must be cautious that when the option comes, whether this research work should be put in the repository, we should say no. Repository means in the memory of the software. So we have to be very cautious that we have to check that it should not be put in the repository memory of the software. Otherwise, second time it will be 100% plagiarized. So that we should tell to our students in advance so that there is no, they must be aware and they are not being misused. Sometimes what happens? Sometimes they take their data, their research work in the pen drive, and some they go to some particular shop and they ask, just sir, please check this of my research work, whether it is free of plagiarism or similarity, just check it. And when he took his or her data in the pen drive, there is no proof that it is his or her work. And the another person, if he is not reliable, he can misuse your research work. So it is always better if you are, you know, giving your research work for checking of the plagiarism or similarity, always send it through email, because that's a proof that it's your research work and you have sent that research work to a particular person just for the checking it. And that two things, they are very, very important. And how to, you know, remove the plagiarism, that is also you have talked about. Ye ab kyunki time constraint hai, aur I have already heard that you have listened to that. So main usko repeat nahi karungi. Just within 2-3 minutes, I'm going to conclude that enforcing this ethical code of conduct within these challenges that are freedom of scholars and good infrastructure, political interference, corrupt practices, bureaucratization of the university, nepotism. That these are the challenges, less copyright, patent innovations, and that is within these challenges to enforce this code of conduct, that is the biggest challenge. And every government laments the absence of the world-class universities, and to achieve the sustainable development goal 4, it's very, very important that teachers, they must help the students to learn the academic basics, but they also teach valuable life lessons by setting a positive example. As role models, teachers must follow a professional code of ethics. This ensures that students receive a fair, honest, and uncompromising education. It has been rightly said, a poor teacher tells, every teacher, and every teacher explains, a good teacher demonstrates, and a great teacher inspires. Yes, the power of inspirations, how it comes? It comes if we follow the ethical code of conduct, professional code of conduct. That's a very, very important, and it should be there. And that's why, you know, we talk about that ethical code of conduct, which is there and it should be, you know, followed. I think that within that particular time frame, I just conclude my session and I will throw it open for your question answer session.
I know I know. Anyone who wants to
Yes, Shivani, there is a question from Sabia Mufti. Ma'am is asking, so I'll put that question that is in the chat box. Professor Mamta, question is, Sabi is asking, ma'am, is code of conduct different from ethics? Because ethics is simply to differentiate between good and bad, but code of conduct include a lot of dimensions.
Yeah, the difference is that ethics tell us only what is good and what is bad. And conduct means to what extent we are following that ethical standard in our practice. Code of conduct. Code of conduct is codified, it's written, especially we have to see that code of conduct for the government servant, it is also there. And a code of conduct for the employees, it is also there. Ethics means something, it's not enforceable. Code of conduct is enforceable. If you violate the code of conduct, the action, disciplinary actions, they are provisions are also there that it can be taken. But ethics, they are not enforceable. Ethical code of conduct, they are not enforceable. They are just a moral force, morality, the guidelines, the standard that tell us that what we should do and what we should not do.
Thank you, ma'am. Lot many compliments. Such a wonderful presentation you had had. But we are unlucky that electricity problem was there, but now it has, you know, come, thank God. But still, the way you carried your, you know, discourse, that was wonderful. Shivani, would you like to?
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was such an interesting and a wonderful presentation.